Hello, AvAdvantage microeconomics students. So we are quickly approaching the end of the course, just 2 weeks left. Posting this a little bit early today because I'm doing some traveling this week. So it's August 1st, but again, August 3rd will be at the start of our new week. So just make sure to wrap up everything from week 6. With week 7, you have the added writing assignment. You all did quite well on the writing assignment last time, so just continue with that. Minimum of 2 pages, no more than 3. You're going to focus on looking at issues related to microeconomics and hospitals. So just follow the prompt and that week. And if you have any questions, do email me, but I expect you'll do fine with that. Just focus on the question. And there's plenty of stuff out there, especially with COVID-19 and issues that hospitals are having to deal with right now. So this week you have the readings of chapter 27 and 30. I'll talk about those in a little bit, and the Pearson exercises. So this week, strongly encourage you, jump in early to the forum discussion. Don't wait till later in the week, just because it's going to be a really busy weekend if you do that. A little bit about this week. So, decisions about, you think about terms of industry regulation. There's the FTC, FDA, EPA, OSHA. One thing about the United States is that we do have well-developed institutions, but they also increase the cost, and they're in place to provide protection to consumers, to provide protection to workers. So it improves our standard of living. We want to have these things. But a lot of times you'll hear in the business world, and to a degree economists too, about the cost or the burden that this brings about. There are trade-offs as with anything. So as we have more regulation, for example, after the subprime crisis, there was a lot of financial regulation, a lot of changes, the Frank-Dodd Act. During Elizabeth Warren, she was one of the candidates to run for president on the Democratic side. Her and Obama put a lot of rules in place, new laws with the credit card industry. They made it much more stringent. And whether people actually change their behavior about how they use credit cards, probably not so much. But it increased a lot of the cost of complying to those regulations. I work in higher education. We are probably one of the most highly regulated industries in the world. And for you as students, it also increases the cost because there's a lot more compliance that we have to make sure that we're doing. These things are important. But it's also, it's a trade-off. So it increases the overall cost. So just saying that, although government has good intentions sometimes, when there's so many rules and so much regulation to follow, it can become overwhelming for an organization. So a lot of times you'll see the lobbying go back and forth between what is the right amount of regulation for a particular industry, because we definitely want people to be safe. At what point, because it hits that tipping point where it becomes an overburden for the industry, or it makes us less competitive, as some of you all have mentioned in other forum discussions, with parts being produced maybe in Mexico. This past week, I remember reading about that. It can decrease the cost, but their safety standards are not as good as their standard of living, so it becomes unethical. So I'd say there's a lot of ethical and questions of illegal, too, as we establish these laws. So these laws that you read about on page 612, this goes all the way back to Rockefeller in the days of control of one person having so much control of a resource. At one point, Rockefeller controlled about 90% of the world oil production. A very smart guy. He was just a 30-year-old accountant, kind of figured out a way that if he could control the oil coming out of these backwood places like Pennsylvania through the railroads, he would have an advantage. So he made a secret deal with the railroads for pricing, and other competitors found out, and they got nervous, and they sold to Rockefeller at rock bottom prices because they didn't want to lose their shirt. And then shortly he controlled everything. He even didn't like that the industry was not a monopoly, because he viewed oil as fluctuating all over the place, and at least with him controlling it, he could determine the price and set a reasonable profit, what he felt was good for him. And he kind of told his wife sometimes you have to go against the grain. But a lot of people did not like Rockefeller. They protested. There was a big suit the government brought in, and even when the government tried to punish him, he more than tripled his wealth because he told on a golf course all his buddies that go out and buy Standard Oil, because he still controlled the majority of the oil. It was just a breakup of the company. So even when the government tried to punish him, he was still rewarded. And in real terms, Rockefeller was the richest man to ever live, far outpaces any Jeff Bezos or Bill Gates today. His wealth was just so great at that time period. I don't think we'll ever historically, in real terms, not nominal, real terms, anybody will ever have a higher amount of income and wealth that he had. So getting into the next chapter, and just to wrap up with that, you know, the Justice Department, they're the department that looks at a lot of these antitrust cases and makes decisions about illegal pricing practices. You know, textbook gave some example like Titan practices that, well, in order to buy this, you have to buy this too. I think that's what Microsoft got a little bit in trouble with too, with their pricing of the software with the computers. We get the next chapter. It's going to talk about income. One of the big things they highlight first is the Lorenz curve. The Lorenz curve is eye-opening because it shows a percentage of income breakdown as kind of like 20%. You know, if you took up 20% of the population, 20% of the population, 20%, 20%, and 20%. And if you were to look at such things as the income distribution between those percentages, it's saying, you know, about 40% of the population only has about 13% of the income in the United States. And the top 20%, 20% of the people in the United States have almost about half, 48.9%. So it's a concern because it talks about the standard of living distribution. Some may question, you know, why does this continue allowed to be exist? There's been arguments of what we call meritocracy, that if you could work hard, that you can achieve these gains. But there's also others that are frustrated that says that that's not a reality. Not everybody has equal access to capital or a chance to advance themselves in careers for various reasons. But if you look at the wealth part, that's where it even gets scarier. This is what I kind of mentioned, like the Bill Gates, the Jeff Bezos, and the Warren Buffetts. It's saying like 3% of the population controls about 53% of the wealth. You know, so it's very lopsided, and this gap has been growing for years. So it's a question, you know, what is equitable, what is fair, what is right? I say you want to have some incentive out there for income to do better. We know in economics, private property rights are important, or having some incentive to try to improve yourself. You all are going to school in the hopes to advance yourselves and your income. And, you know, that it requires a lot of work and effort to do that. So, but we know that, you know, the more advanced degrees that you have, typically the higher your income levels are too. So there has to be some incentive there, but it's a question of that. At what point is too much? And what point does distribution become an issue? Because you have so many Americans that are not living the same standard of living as a very few. So some other things there, the readings you're going to talk about is the social, also, you know, the human capital. I call it social and cultural capital that people build up. Some people may have advantages just because the household that they grew up in, how they helped guide them through, this is what you need to study, this is how you need to prepare for the ACT, these are the schools that you need to go to. There's even some studies that some students undermatch with the type of university they should be going to. It actually limits their potential to increase their income and career, but they don't know, so they just go to a community college when they could be going to Harvard or Yale or something like that. So they might have like a 35 ACT and they should be going to these better schools. But that's an important part of this too. All right, last thing you're also going to talk about this chapter is about some of the social programs. It could be Medicare, Medicaid, Earned Income Credit, food support programs like this WIC or food stamps, you may know them. And then the last, it's got to tie into your paper, is about the increase in healthcare costs, which has really, you know, skyrocketed over the past 30 years, where it used to only, you know, maybe take 6% of your income back in the 60s, now is almost taking 18%. And many of this they also attribute to the third-party payer system, where insurance is covering some of those. If you were to kind of put this in a supply and demand curve analysis, you know, it's kind of saying, well, the price is here what I'm paying, and You're going to have somebody demanding a lot more than what they're willing to supply. There's this gap. That's when the insurance makes the gap up. And as they mentioned in the text, there could be incentives too in the system where doctors are ordering maybe scans that aren't needed for someone who's terminally ill. There's been a lot of cases out there, especially with the Medicaid fraud. So unfortunately in the United States, we don't have one of the best systems for healthcare as far as controlling the cost as compared to other nations. We do have very good healthcare, and we do have good improvements in technology. But I think that's what the Obama administration was trying to do, is to get the system where it's almost like car insurance, that if you want to drive, everybody had to have insurance. And the idea that if everyone had insurance out there, it would lower the overall cost for everyone. But it never quite made it through in kind of the idea that they were looking for. And there's other issues that the textbook also talked about too, the idea of like moral hazard, understanding, one moral hazard, one party has more information than the other party, so that those search costs and those information costs about what is the best healthcare choice. So, all right, well, that's it for this week. So I hope you all have a great week, and I'm looking forward to the forum discussion online. But if you do have any questions, do email me through Canvas, and I'll talk to you all soon.